Hello and welcome to Latest TV's The Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, and of course, Mark Walker. How are you?
Pretty good, pretty good.
Jolly good. We're looking, of course, at the newspapers, the insides, the outsides, the locals, the nationals. But before we start, we always talk about one thing, and hopefully the season will be over very soon and put us all out of our miseries, but Brighton are safe.
Yeah, by the time the show goes out, the last home game would have happened. So that's Man City at home. I was there for West Ham at home. We should have won, took the lead in, 84th, 85th minute, then letting a goal again. So can't keep a lead. So, yeah, we're pretty safe. 38 points so far. That might be where it ends, really, 38 points. 17th position.
But Brighton are record holders, aren't they? I mean, I think we're number one when it comes to coming from having a lead and then losing.
Yeah.
So we're number one in that one. What else are we number one
draws.
In? Oh, draws. Number one in the draws, yeah.
Yeah, Fulham have drawn 12 games out of the 36 so far, and we've drawn 14 out of the 36. So possibly a draw at home. Away, I should say, against Arsenal. I fancy that to be a draw at the Emirates. So, yeah, that's where we're at.
Of possibilities of players that are going to be available to buy for the summer season, who would you like to see come into Brighton?
Well, there's been talk of that Nketiah from Arsenal. He's a striker that doesn't get looking at the
Gunners. Yeah, 20-year-old, isn't he?
He's pretty young. And then we could sell Basuma to Arsenal for, like, I don't know, 30 million, plus we get Nketiah and 30 million in exchange. So that he could be one. Or a striker, you know, someone from the Championship that can come up. We've got Neil Morpay. Came up, didn't he, from Brentford? So he could be two seasons ago. I think there wasn't. We could get. There's a guy called Tony that plays for Brentford. He could be coming up. So a Championship striker for like 20 million coming up from the Championship could be a way forward. But we'll have to wait.
Our saviour this year has been Welbeck, hasn't he? Really?
And yeah.
Is he going to be here for next year?
I think he'll get 1 year extension. Actually, he's done all right. Yeah, I think so. He can find a back line there. He got us a point because West Ham were all over us over the weekend. Mm. Really didn't deserve to get a point. I wouldn't say Brighton. I mean, we should have won it once we took the lead. But really, overall, West Ham probably on the chances should have probably got 3 points. And it looks like they won't qualify for Europe now, West Ham, because Tottenham and Liverpool have gone above them. So.
Yeah, shame. Big shame. Yeah. OK, let's look at some of the stories now. Let's start off with the local, which is, I think, everyone, music to everyone's ears, isn't it? Come inside. Pubs and restaurants are ready to welcome customers back indoors. That, of course, has happened on Monday. And everyone's gone mad. I've got my booking already in the restaurant, which we're looking forward to. What are your thoughts on going back? Are you going back to normal or are you going to be cautious?
No. Funny enough, I've been to two places. I went to Donatello with my wife, Angie, the other day. And then I went to the American diner.
That's sitting outside, though.
Sitting outside.
Yeah.
I went to the American diner and with my mum the other day, sitting outside. Both times it's pretty chilly. I mean, Donatello, great food, as you would expect from Donatello. Great for the American diner, but just really chilly. So I'm looking forward to going inside. I'll be someone that'd be eating inside rather than outside, unless it's really warm.
Yeah.
So I just prefer it.
It'd be interesting to see if pubs and restaurants are going to go to the scheme we saw late last year, where limited numbers indoors, and would you be able to go to the bar for service, or are you going to have to be served at your table? I don't know what the rules are going to be.
Well, what it is it's table service, as far as I know. You have to be sat down unless you're going to the loo, or you're taking off your jacket. It's table service, I think. So.
And wear masks as well.
Which is what it was last time. So, I mean, to me, that makes sense, to be honest. You know, we've all waited a long time for this, and it makes sense. It's good for local business because they'll still have people outside, but people will be inside as well. I think for me, I haven't been to a pub since the pubs opened, what was it, nearly 5 weeks ago. I want to have a drink inside rather. But I'm looking forward to it. I'll probably go for a drink tomorrow before the game, to be honest. So.
I mean, I may be nasty about this, but I think a lot of, and I know they deserve, well, they want the business, so they deserve business at times, but a lot of restaurants and bars and coffee shops have taken a bit of a liberty on the way they've sort of encroached or encroached into the streets, haven't they, really, taken pavements over.
Yeah, you can't blame them. I mean, they need
to say you don't blame them, but I think it's wrong.
Yeah.
And will they be able to continue this once we're back to
normal? Yeah, I mean, not sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, some of them might need that space, will they? You've got to feel sorry for the places like we have the Mucky Duck along the road from us, which doesn't have outside space.
No. Yeah.
So, I know what you mean. I've seen that you can't blame them. They want to make their money. So hopefully that will be.
But the council were very contradictory because look at St James's Street. They've taken away a lot of the parking areas, which, I mean, we know the council's anti-cars area. So they've taken away the parking areas and the reason being to give people more room on the pavement. So what happens? Restaurants and coffee shops have now put all their tables in the area that would have been the parking areas. So there's still no room for people to walk through. Exactly. It's crazy, isn't it? But no one's probably bothered to enforce this.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. I mean, there isn't. I mean, there's people enforcing the COVID, that you're complying with all of the COVID regulations, but I don't, in terms of the that area, I mean, I think that was why they actually took away the parking spaces, so that you could have a kind of a cafe society down St James Street.
Is that right?
I think that
Which is different to the reason they originally gave.
Yeah. Yeah.
The original reason was to give people room, the 2 metres between each other when you're walking on the street.
Yeah.
Never mind. Okay, the next one's a national one that you found. We tried to go out, but it's we're sticking here, of course, with COVID and fears of COVID. But it's been really stressful, fears of the COVID warriors.
Yeah, there are people that, you hear it on the radio a lot. I mean, I don't know anyone personally that's not gone out. But, yeah, there's some people that have been really affected, brought on anxiety. And, they're still struggling to get out. I mean, there's some lady here who from Cheshire, she's been trying to go out, but she's really, she finds it very anxiety-provoking and stressful. Her imagination runs wild. So you can understand that, because we're getting mixed messaging all the time. You know, we had Eat Out to Help Out, where we were encouraged to go out, then we had another lockdown. Now we're going back out again. We might have another lockdown later in the year. There's been talk of it, hasn't there? We'll see where we're at with the vaccination program.
I think the Prime Minister is totally against it, but it could happen.
Yeah, so you can see, exactly. So some people might have had pre-existing conditions, mental health conditions, and this isn't going to help when you've got, there's all this talk of the Indian variant and all the rest of it. The only thing you can say is, if you can, get vaccinated, because that's going to help you a lot.
Yeah. I know a number of sort of elderly friends of mine have been virtually at home for a year and are now terrified to go out. They just will not go out.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Strange. Okay, next story is a local one. And I say it's local, it's more national, really, isn't it? But, of course, being the Duke of Sussex, it makes it local. Duke aims to break cycle of suffering. Harry shared his goals to avoid bringing his kids up like him. The Duke of Sussex has said he wants to break the cycle of the pain and suffering of his upbringing with his own children. Well, that's a bit of a sideways knock at his father, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Queen.
Yeah, it's difficult. I don't really get it, where he's coming from after time, because... he says he doesn't want media attention, then he doesn't.
Then he goes straight to the media with the story, yeah.
Then we hear that he's doing a whole series on mental health issues with Oprah Winfrey. So, we're going to hear a lot from the Duke. It's good that he's talking about mental health issues, that's great, but knocking your dad probably isn't the thing to do, given that his dad's just lost his father, Duke of Edinburgh. So, not really sure where he's coming from. But there's mixed views on it, isn't there? On Meghan and the Duke. So let's see what happens. I mean, there is talk of taking their titles away. I think that I can see that happening quite soon, that they'll get their royal titles taken away.
I wouldn't be surprised the way they're going. OK, just quickly getting one in before the break. This one is one that you found. Gig economy, music, art and theatre shows selling out fast.
Yeah, exactly. So we've just done some news pieces on The Warren, for example, that's taking place in the... Vanity Gardens, there's events taking place, Brighton Festival, lots of events taking place in the city. You can go out and have a pint inside, as we spoke of before. Yeah, culture's returning and people can't get enough of it. I think you'll find some people that will be going out almost every night, I would have thought, just to get their cultural fix. So, and that's good for the city, it's good for places like Worthing as well, and Lancing, I'm sure all different areas are
going to have different
events going on.
I mean, the Rope Tackle is already, so I think, fully booked for everything they've got coming up. We've got a lot of new shows coming in, of course, there. I think Worthing Theatres has got a very full programme of events coming up. But I think it's going to be limited seating, isn't it, a lot of these places there?
Yeah, it is. I mean, so, yeah, you've got sporting arenas, theatres, maximum capacity of 1,000 for some of them, outdoor up to 4,000. Brighton of Albion, I think it's around 8,000 people are going to be there for Man City tomorrow.
Out of 32,000 it can take?
Yeah, out of 32, which they'll make a noise. I mean, that was more than last time.
Yeah.
So 8,000 people, it would be interesting. So, and it would just be good to see the champions, because obviously we'll have to give them a card of honour.
I mean, the cup final last weekend, of course, there was a small crowd there, but they certainly were vocal, weren't they?
Yeah, 8,000 can make a bit of a noise. I mean, I'm not being funny, but a lot of kind of Division 1, 2 clubs, that's their crowd.
Yeah.
It's only Brighton are a bigger club now, that we get big crowds, and 8,000 to us doesn't seem a lot.
But I know, it just seems crazy.
Yeah.
And I feel sorry for those who have bought season tickets, sort of not being able to go and still can't go.
Yeah.
And they've got to be in the draw, and you've still got to pay when you go as well.
Yeah.
So I don't know how they work this out, but next year's going to be very interesting. Whether it goes back to a full capacity for next season.
Yeah, exactly.
We won't know, will we, until after June. Mind you, isn't it June that's meant to go back to full? Is it June the 21st? If that comes in.
If that comes in, and then the new season will start in August, so we'll have
a short break.
Yeah, it'll be a slightly shorter break than normal, but it'll start up again in 2 months after the Euros.
Yeah, fine.
So we got a whole summer of football, to be honest, and plus we've got the Olympics, so there's a lot taking place.
Well, there's a lot of criticism about that as well, whether the Olympics should go ahead.
Yeah.
No, a lot of people don't think it should.
Yeah.
I think it's really going to call it blood money because they think a lot of people are going to be affected by that.
Yeah.
Or affected and infected at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay, we're just about run out of time for the first part of the programme. You're watching The Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, and of course, Mark Walker as well. We'll be back in the second half with lots of interesting stories. And last week we were talking about toilets. Guess what the first story is? Toilets yet again. Back after the break. Don't go away. Welcome back to The Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, and of course Mark Walker as well, looking at the newspapers, the inside, the outside, the sideways as well, of local and national papers. The next one, in fact, is a local story which I've come across. And last week we were talking about the 9 pop-up loos that suddenly arrived on Hove lawns. Well, now Councillor Chris Henry, who's a Labour councillor, is calling for deep clean of public toilets in the city. I don't know why, I'm sure he's got his reasoning, but I would have thought, having got rid of all the toilet attendants that we used to have, was a bad move, because, you know, toilets around Brighton and Hove were always spotless, and there used to be competitions. I think we mentioned this last time.
Yeah.
Competitions between the different people who look, the toilet attendants who used to look after the toilets, and they'd be fighting each other to get the crown each year.
Yeah.
But now they got rid of them all. The toilets have gone totally into disrepair.
Town Hall, you were saying, was
particular. Well, that's what that one there kept winning awards non-stop.
Yeah.
You know, the person who looked after those toilets used to paint them herself, used to put little decorations up in the toilets and everything, and it was always spotlessly clean. But now they're calling for deep cleaning of the toilets because they're in such a terrible state.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, exactly. So we'll see. I mean, we've got temporary toilets there, haven't we? I mean, Councillor Chris Henry, Labour councillor, there's kind of criticising, saying that we need cleaner toilets before the summer tourist season kicks off. And I think he's probably right, actually, to be fair, because we are going to get a massive amount of tourists, I think. Coming over the summer. I was on Brighton seafront over the weekend on Saturday and it was absolutely heaving, to be fair, down there on the seafront. So, that makes sense. People are out and about. And
apparently 24 more portaloos have been now put on the lawns down the seafront as well. But they're going to be 24 hours, 24/7 for the toilets along that part of the seafront. Yeah. I think it's going to be very dodgy, you know. You're going to have people sleeping in there, I think, for a start. You'll find homeless people sleeping in the toilets. And goodness knows what else is going to go on in those toilets.
Yeah.
There should be some type of security along there.
Possibly, yeah. We'll wait and see what happens if that happens.
OK, next one is a national that you've picked up. What Jackie Weaver did next?
Yeah. What she did next is she's got...
Well, how about saying who is Jackie Weaver?
Well, she was the clerk to that famous...
parish council.
Parish council meeting, where it all kind of kicked off, really. She had to intervene. There were people kicked out of the meeting. I mean, if you type in Jackie Weaver, you're sure to find it. It's worth a listen. It's quite... it's really interesting, isn't it? Tempers flare. People are stuck in online waiting rooms. You name it, it happens. She's now got a book, a podcast, and she's going to have a secret part in the Archers. So she's probably the winner out of that one.
Was she a clerk of the council or something?
She was brought in. She's part of the local government association, I think. And so she was brought in to manage that meeting, and that meeting went spectacularly wrong. So,
but good for her. It's made her a star.
It has made her a star.
Unbelievable. Yeah. Okay, next one. Longer days at schools could be on the cards. Quite possible. A leading think tank believes that children may need to spend longer hours at school in order to get their learning back on track once the coronavirus pandemic is finally conquered.
Yeah, I had a chat with Paul Shallard from the National Education Union about this.
Oh, yeah.
He wasn't so convinced that we were going to get longer days, but it's mixed feelings, isn't it? Do you catch up or do you kind of make sure that you're doing all right at school? And, I mean, do you need to catch up? I mean, I think you often do need to catch up, but people have different views, don't they? Longer hours at school makes sense to me, but maybe not everyone, because they could think that we're kind of, overworking our young people. But, it looks like some schools will be having longer days.
I think that the older kids, the sort of senior schools, should have longer hours. I know when I one of the schools I went to, one of my last schools, which was actually Pittman's College, and the idea was to work business hours. You got used to when you leave school or leave college that you would be able to get used to a business environment. And we did 9 till 5 at school.
Yeah.
Which I think were great hours to do.
Yeah, and it's normally, what, 9 till 3, so it makes sense.
Yeah, without a doubt. What time is it now? Is it 9?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
I think a lot of academies, they do special classes, it's all 7:30
in the
morning. Yeah,
and you have breakfast clubs and stuff, which means you start a bit earlier.
Which is not a bad idea, actually. I think the more you get kids involved in different activities, I think it's absolutely perfect, really. Okay, next one. Shun celebrity authors like Megan. Publishers are urged.
Yeah.
Every man in his book is writing a book now, isn't he?
Yeah, everyone's writing a book. We've got Paul McCartney, David Walliams, we've got Madonna, we've got obviously Meghan Markle using the royal title there.
Every chef has now got a book out, they're starting to become celebrities.
I mean, I don't read any of these books, if I'm being totally honest about it. I mean, I have trouble reading the books I've got, and I normally go for quality rather than the actual, who's on the front of the book, whose name's on the front of the book. So, yeah, it's not for me, but they must shift books. I mean, Paul McCartney, you can imagine him shifting quite a few books. His famous name, Meghan, the same, probably in the American market. Madonna's shifting books. So, you know, Walliams, I've not seen his books, but I've heard good things about David Walliams. So I think they're actually quite well received by kids. Everyone's doing it. But the point here is that maybe we should go for other less known authors because, you know, there might be better quality. And also you're helping out other people rather
like
than...
Like Peter James.
Well, he's more of a national...
He would have been nothing, would he? He has become, a household name almost now.
Yes.
Another TV series I hear coming up as well.
Yeah. So he's a good example of a local author done good, actually. So you're right. You're right. And I've got... Well, everyone's got a Peter James book, and I've got two of these. So
I've got all his books. I haven't read them yet, but I've got all his books.
Yeah.
All signed.
Yeah.
But I thought one day on eBay they're going to be worth a small fortune.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
But I did go through a stage where my radio show was, I used to sort of look at books and talk about books and talk to the authors and what have you. I never read any of them. I had a whole bookshelf just full of books that were given to me, all signed. But one of my researchers would do all the research and just give me the notes.
Yeah.
And of course, when they got the research wrong and I asked the author a particular question, it was very embarrassing when it was a wrong question, really.
Yeah.
I remember once, it was one of the Crays, I think. No, Richardson. You ever heard of the Richardson gang?
Yeah, the Richardson gang.
I interviewed one of the Richardsons as he came out of prison, and he'd written a book. So I said, thanks for coming to the studio, and let's talk about your book. He said, I'm not going to talk about the book. I said, why not? He said, they can buy the book if they want to read about the book. He said, don't ask me questions about the book. And I said, well, that's what you're here for. And I thought he was going to punch me there and then.
Yeah.
What's the point of coming in for an interview and not being able to talk about the thing you're going to talk about?
Yeah. Bizarre, really.
Absolutely
bizarre,
crazy.
Yeah.
That really scared me, actually, seeing this big thug coming.
Well, look, lucky you survived it.
Just about,
with the Richardson game, yeah.
Okay, the other one's famous for nailing people's heads to the floor, weren't they, I think?
Yeah.
Bid for fish and chip shop. Late licence has been rejected. Now, there's no to plans to stay open until 3 o'clock and later at weekends. I suppose if the toilets along Hove Seafront have been open all night, you want somewhere to go after you've been for your kebab and your fish and chips.
Yeah, exactly. So, I know that fish and chip shop as well. So, I mean, everyone's getting a license nowadays, isn't it? So,
it's in Preston Street, by the way.
Yeah, it's in Preston Street. Lots of other places along Preston Street have late licenses. So,
well, look on the seafront. Half those places are open all night, aren't they?
Exactly.
The big Burger King that's along there. And
so I've got a bit of sympathy here, to be honest, with this one. Because, why can't he have a license if everyone else is getting a license?
And it's not really a residential area anymore, though, is it?
Yeah, and also the other point here is that we're kind of more of a 24-hour city anyway. So, I mean, it's probably one of the places along the south coast where if you want a drink at 3 o'clock in normal times, you can probably get a drink at 3 o'clock. There's not many places like that, is there?
Exactly. I think they're totally wrong to turn it down, but that's I'm sure they can go to appeal and something will happen on that one. Okay, next one is a national one. Red Wall voters think Labour cares more about the Palestinians than them, and maybe they're right.
Possibly, yeah. I mean, there is an obsession with Palestine, I think, on the left. I have to say that. I know this not just from, people I speak to locally, but, former colleagues of mine obsessed by it, actually, more than... Very strange. Obsessed by... with Palestine, which obviously, we're going to go into the conflict, but it's obviously there's views on different sides there. But two sides to every story. But they seem to be more obsessed about Palestine than they do, like kind of local issues, which you'd think be more relevant to them and their everyday life. So, I mean, obviously they're entitled to their views, but it doesn't go down well when you're trying to get those Red Wall voters that cut in Hartlepool in other areas in the Midlands. You're trying to convince a voter, and then you're kind of going on about Palestine when obviously, you know, they're more about the bins, the kind of, local park, crime, schools, education, you name it. They have different priorities. So it is an issue, I think.
Were you surprised at the cup final the other day, at the end of it, when they were celebrating, two of the players suddenly walked around with Palestinian flags?
Yeah, I didn't see that, because I actually missed the cup final. I was on my way to the Amex Stadium to watch West Ham versus Brighton versus West Ham.
Far more exciting. Okay, we've got just about enough time to get this one in. Schools are giving transgender girls boys' names and not telling their parents.
I bet they go home and tell their parents. And I know that this is an issue in Brighton as well. And I know that I think Councillor Hannah Clare is quoted in this, who is from Deputy Leader of the Council. I speak to very regularly, and also a part of the Children, Young People and Skills Committee. So, yeah, it's an issue here. Kids getting changing names, but not parents not being told. So there's kind of an issue there with, accountability and about parents being informed about what's going on at school.
It's not that often you hear about transgender girls becoming boys. You hear far more about boys becoming girls, don't you, really?
You certainly do, yeah.
I must say, I've met quite a few recently. In fact, I met a fireman the other day, a Crawley fireman, who's one of the biggest firemen I've ever seen in my life, covered in tattoos, hair completely shaved, all tattoos on the head, and she's quite famous. Well, I say she because it actually is a woman.
Yeah.
And it's just amazing that they're very happy in their own body.
Yeah, which is good.
Brilliant. Yeah.
And that's important. So it's a complicated issue here, and I think it's more about parents. Having the right to be told. That's
exactly.
The big issue there.
Okay, listen, we've run out of time, unfortunately, but thank you so much for today. Thank you. Thanks for watching. This has been the Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, and of course, Mark Walker. We're back again very soon with another edition of the newspapers. Till then, stay safe. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.
Goodbye.